Hi, it's Bob Kraft of TennisMinistry.org, and you know, I'm talking about various players I've had contact with. I think there's a lot to be learned from these players, and people who want to do something similar, reach out to players for Christ. I encourage that, and I believe God can do that for somebody who has that desire to do that. But I'd like to talk to you a little bit about a player that means a lot to me because I taught her when she was 5 and 6 years old up to the age of 11. And her name is Christina McHale. Now, she may not be a well-known player to you, but I would like to give you a little background on her. She is one of the top players in the U.S. now. She's playing on the Fed Cup. She's a very young player, up in the around 20 years old, just entered into the adult stage, you could say. She had a different career path, and I'd like to kind of share with you a little bit about that. For a coach, I hope that you find it interesting, but there's also some spiritual aspects to this too. She started out young, she and her sister Lauren. I was actually running a program in Hong Kong. Her father was a businessman and her mother was a housewife here. And they brought them to me. It was a program where I put kids into tournaments and they played and they went on and had some success, you could say, some of these group of kids. Christina was one of them. She was very young. Her sister Lauren was a couple years older. I got them at the same time. They came to me and they really couldn't play. I had to teach them how to score. I had to teach them how to serve, how to hit balls over the net. The thing that I did was, because there was that sister relationship, Christina always looked up to her older sister. Now, they were different in personality. There is no doubt about that. But Christina was always the kind of player that looked up to her sister and tried to emulate what she did and tried to do just as well as her older sister. I remember that I had a tough decision because Christina was not really good enough to get in with the older kids to play tennis. The kids who were 2 and 3 years older and even up to 4 years. Rocco Lee, okay, was a player who was one of these, my top player at that time, and he was about 4 years older. He went on and ended up playing a collegiate career in the Eastern United States and was the conference champion. So she wasn't able to fit in, and I remember going to her mother and saying, "You really need to give her some private lessons. I need to give her some private lessons. Otherwise, she can't just fit in. She can't serve. She can't hit the ball over the net." And that was a tough decision because the other kids didn't really want to play with her. When I had the groups, she couldn't hit the ball over the net. And I could see, you know, number one, I had two sisters that I wanted to keep together. And the mother was very athletic and the father was very athletic and they were very supportive. So I wanted them in my program. But on the other hand, you know, I recognized that it wasn't easy. The other kids, I couldn't offend them and the parents, and they would quit the program. So what happened was that Christina took a couple private lessons and I got her to the point where she could hit a serve, she could hit the ball over the net, and then I could put her in with the other kids. And I remember going to her mother, Margarita, who was the primary force of her tennis lessons, and saying, "Well, you know, I support them playing any kind of tournament. If you belong to a private club, there was the American club, there was another club here in Hong Kong, go to that club and put her in the tournaments. Every tournament you can, every competition, find a way to get her, your kids in that." And she said, "Yeah, I agree with that." So they would put them in all the tournaments. To the best of my knowledge, they didn't really sign them up for the lessons at these other places. And then we talked about that, and she said, "No, we haven't done that," because they were taking lessons from me about 3 times a week. And then I had like one time of privates, if I remember, a few times of privates. So that was the way it was set up. So it was mostly just getting them in the competition. And this is still the same way I work with players. And I told the mother, I said, "Well, we need to, you know, be there and encourage her and, you know, be there, not be tough on her, don't coach her. That's what I need to be doing, but be there encouraging her every time she's playing." And we would play club matches against other clubs. I would take some of my kids to another club and we'd play, and I remember I took her to a club called the Pacific Club and her sister, and they played against these other kids, and that was really the first competition as I remember that she had, where she played other people. Now, I had her until she was, say, 10 or 11, around that age, and then they just moved away. Her father got transferred back to New Jersey, and they moved away. And, you know, I didn't really think they were going to be great players. They were just kids who liked tennis. They could hit pretty well for their age. That was pretty much it. They played competition, and it wasn't until she was playing the Australian Open as a junior that I even knew she continued to play, and her sister, and I had no contact with the family. Her mother heard my voice at the Australian Open in the players area, and she said, "Is that Bob Kraft?" And I turn, and it's her mother, and then Christina's right there, and Christina was playing the junior and the women's singles. She got into the women's singles event. Very unusual to have a junior player and playing in the women's singles. So from that moment on, I started to spend time with them. And I told them what I was doing, that I'd been on the tour. Now, I had made the transition into the pro tour after I'd worked with them. And they didn't even know that. So we started talking. I went out and watched all her matches. She played and lost a very tough match to the number world-ranked junior player named Laura Robinson, and from England. And she could have won that match. She had match points. And, you know, there was a real determination about her that goes beyond hitting a tennis ball. And it's to be the best at what she does. I think that's the way I would phrase that. And I spent a whole many hours. And then they went on and won the doubles, junior doubles event, she and her partner. And I was there. I got video of it. And, you know, I was so happy to come off and celebrate. And she was so happy to see me. And she lost the women's singles to Laura, but it was close. She could have won. She got sick is what happened. She wasn't used to the heat. And her coach, Carlos Cano, had actually left. He had to go back and returned home. Now, after she went to the U.S., she started working with Carlos, as I understand it, in New Jersey at the Tenafly Racquet Club. And a few years later, I got a chance to ask Carlos, well, what did you do differently? Because what I saw with Christina was, within a year's time after she returned to the U.S., she was the number one ranked player in the 12 and under, and 14 and under, and 16 and under. So, truthfully, I think that what I did had some huge impact on her, because how could you leave from Hong Kong and all of a sudden, within a year's time, be number one in your age division in the U.S.? It says a lot, you know? So, but there were things, I could never get a player to be a pro-level player that I had coached. I could get them to get scholarships. For example, Lauren, Christina's sister, had went to Princeton and University of North Carolina and played on the tennis team. But I couldn't get them into the pro ranks. And I often wondered about that. Well, it took learning about the pro players, what they do differently from a college player or from a very good challenger player, what they do differently to get into the pro ranks. I learned that over 10 years on the pro tour and talking to a number of coaches. And so I got a chance to talk to Carlos and Christina at the last tournament, which was the Pilot Pin in New Haven, Connecticut in the year 2010. And I said, well, what did you do differently? And he said, well, I changed her grip on her serve, because I had taught an Eastern grip at that time just to get her to hit the ball over the net, get it in. You know, she wasn't strong enough to hit it. And I didn't make the transition to the semi-Western grip. And pretty much everything else was the same. When I see her hit the ball, I see how she hits the ball, and it's pretty much what I would teach. So I think she kept most of those things, and she's had a really great career. She's playing Fed Cup. By the time she's 19, she's in the top 150. She might even be in the top 100 now, and she has that real determination to do well. But the point I'd like to make is the decision that I had to make when she was 7, 8, 6, 7, 8, 9, to keep her with the older kids playing when it went against what the other kids wanted. That was a very tough decision. And I'm very emotional about that, because nobody knows how much pressure I was under from the other parents and from the other kids to have some young person playing tennis with kids that were 3 or 4 years older and better. And that was a very, very tough decision. And I can tear up, and I did when I was with Christina, over that. Nobody knows how that feels to have people around you saying, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? This isn't right. We're going to quit your program, you know, or whatever, like that. But you're making a decision based upon that one player because it's the right thing to do. And that was a tough decision. So that's the point I'd like to leave. I'm so happy that Christina was able to transition into the pro ranks, and she went from juniors directly to pros. That's her desire. She's traveling the world now, and we wish her the best. So that's the story of Christina McHale. Now, there is a spiritual element to it, which I didn't share with you. It has to do with how her family went from one country where they were kind of refugees to before Christina and Lauren were born, to another country as refugees, and then back to the U.S. all with the church assistance.